Hello everybody, my name is Michaela Boyko. I'm one of the technology tutors here at the University of Southern Maine, and today I'm going to be discussing how to use Zoom for group meetings. Here at the Learning Commons, we use Zoom primarily for connecting students with tutors for online appointments, but that's not its only function. Since you as a student already have a Zoom account, thanks to the university, you can use it for your own personal academic means. Have a project and need a way to communicate with everyone? Setting up a meeting or interview? You can use Zoom. Zoom is very similar to Skype or even Adobe Connect in execution, but has a more user-friendly interface. So how do you make a Zoom meeting? Well, first you need to download the plugin and the application onto your device. So if you go to Zoom's website, which is zoom.us, and scroll down to the very bottom and click this download link here, you'll be brought to a web page with downloads that are available to you. The one that we're really interested in, though, is the Zoom client for meetings. This will download both the desktop application as well as the plugin that is available for Chrome and Firefox browsers. Once you have Zoom installed, you can then go to your MyUSM portal. Once you're in your portal, go to the Launchpad and find the Zoom tile. From here, there are two options to start your meeting. If you need to make a meeting on the spot, you will click on the Host button. Or, if you want to schedule a meeting for later in the future, you will click the Sign In button. Both of these options have different processes for how to invite people into your meeting, so let's focus on one of them for now. If you choose the Host button, this will start a new Zoom meeting. You'll be launched into an empty meeting room with only you in it. In order to get more people into your meeting room, you have to go over to the Invite tab down here, click on Email, and then click on Gmail. This will open up a new email with the body of text already filled out. This body of text should provide the link to the meeting room as well as the personal ID. All you need to enter are the emails of the people you want to invite into the meeting and something in the subject line to tell them it's for Zoom. After that, hit send and then just wait for your guests to flow in. If you click on the sign in button, and it should automatically bring you to the Meetings tab. You then can click on Schedule a New Meeting. This will bring you to the form in which you will fill out all the information needed for the meeting. Things that will need to be in the form and filled out will be the topic, when it's taking place, the duration, and the time zone, just to make sure that that's correct. Everything else you can play around with or just activate it as needed. Once it's done, you can hit Save. And this will bring you to a page where you can review the details of your meeting again. Now on this page, make sure you hit the Google Calendar option under the Calendar section to save the meeting in Google Calendar. Zoom will open up your browser and automatically bring up a new event for you to customize. Obviously, make sure you double check that the time, date, and time zone are correct, as well as making sure that the description text box is filled out with the link to your Zoom room as well as the personal ID. Once that's all set, the last thing to do is to add guests for your invitation to be sent out to. Once everything's filled out and you've invited your guests, you can then hit save. This will ask to send the invitations. You'll say yes. If you have anybody in your meeting room who is not using a main.edu account, it'll ask you if you want to invite external guests. This is where the personal ID is going to come in handy. With the personal ID, this is going to be how the external guests get into your meeting. So if that's correct, you'll hit invite external guests. Now that your meeting is all set, if you click on your meeting in Google Calendar, you'll see all your details, and then you can click on the link in order to access your meeting room. So those are both the ways that you can make and access Zoom from the application. The plugin follows a similar process of having two options to open and make meetings. The only difference is when you choose to schedule a meeting, it will automatically take you to Google Calendar if you are signed in with your Google account. Now it is important to mention some information beforehand about the roles of the participant and the host. So whoever makes the meeting defaults to be the host. There can only be one host within each meeting, but you can change who is the host by assigning them that role, therefore giving up your role of the host. So let me show you what I mean. So if you go into the Manage Participants section, it'll open up the side panel. Now, your name will always appear at the top of the participants list, as well as your role in the meeting. So for me, I'm the host. The student doesn't have anything. They're just a participant. But if I wanted to assign them host roles, I could. And as you see, I lost some of my icons here because now I'm known as just the participant. But whoever the original host was, though, can reclaim their role as host at any time during the meeting. So if I want to, I can just hit this button down at the bottom that says Claim Host, and I take back my role as host. The student then goes back down to being a participant, and I get all my nice little icons back. There's also another role similar to the host called the co-host that you can assign. That will allow the original host to keep their privileges while also giving some of those privileges to someone else. You can also take back the co-host permissions by just going down to the more and hitting withdraw co-host permission. This will then make them a participant again. As you would expect, the host, the co-host, and the participant have access to different features, with the host being the only role that has access to everything that's on the screen. Co-hosts have access to almost everything on the screen, with the exclusion being the closed captions and the breakout rooms. The participant also has these exclusions as well, as not being able to record meetings or make polls. On most occasions, you may not need these features, but it's good to know they are there and who has access to them. Now let me carefully go over some of these icons and what each of them do. So here on the very far left, you have your traditional audio and video. I've turned off both of these for this recording as I don't want any backlash or have to deal with the hassle when editing. Next to that, you have the invite tab. This we covered during the previous segment of doing the immediate meeting. The manage participants tab, which opens up that panel so that you can see who is in your meeting. The number on the bust here of the figures indicates how many people are in the meeting. You have the poll icon, which is basically just questions that you can ask. So if I launch this once to test it, but if I relaunch it, hit continue. So this is what it looks like on my side. On the participants side, they see something very similar, but it's just a pop-up window. My participant has answered, and so now it shows here. So now if I end the poll, there's that. And then if I want to, I can share the results. This will share the results with everybody so that they can all see what the final result was. This green icon right here, the share icon, this is basically screen sharing, but it has a few added features with it that are not usually seen in most screen sharing applications. So you have your typical screen sharing applications, such as your desktop, web pages, and certain documents, but you also have the added effect of being able to screen share like other devices such as your phone or your iPad. And the other one that we're really excited about, and the one that could be used most often with people now, is the whiteboard function. And so as you can see, this has given me just a blank canvas to work with. You guys can't see it, but on my other laptop, which I have my other account on to be the participant, you can actually see where the mouse is moving so that people know, like the other participants in the meeting know where you're pointing to things or where you know, you're moving your mouse to. The other nice thing about this is let's just say I was working on math problems with a group and we wanted to work simultaneously on something. I can write something down, and then the other people that I'm sharing this with can then write something in afterwards. So you can also save the whiteboard. While both the host and its participants have the ability to use the screen sharing application, only one of them has the ability to save the whiteboard. And the person that has that ability is the one that opened up screen sharing and is the one that is sharing the whiteboard. And so therefore, me as the host who opened up the whiteboard to share it has the save icon. The participant doesn't, unfortunately, so they won't be able to share it. But obviously, if you have something that you want to share with your other groupmates, you can save it onto your computer, and then you can email it or send it via chat, however you wish to do it. So after you're done, unfortunately, if you're not the person who opened up the whiteboard, you're kind of a victim of whoever did. The person who opened up the whiteboard has to make sure that they stop sharing the whiteboard by going up to here and hitting stop sharing. This will then boot everybody out of the whiteboard function and will bring everybody back to the video. So as mentioned before, there is a chat function. You can bring that up and it will appear on the side panel under your participants page, and you have the option to do private chat or speak to everybody depending on who is in the room with you. If you are the host, you also have access to being able to record the meeting. This will save depending on where you specify. So if you hit the cloud, this will save it onto your Zoom account through the MyUSM portal. Or if you say onto this computer, it will save inside of a folder inside of your documents folder. The closed captions, just text on the bottom of the screen. If you're very familiar with YouTube and their closed captions, it's very similar to that. So there's a couple different options with this. You can either assign somebody to basically be the scribe, you can do it yourself, or if you have a online product or a product that you've bought that will automatically do the closed captions for you, you can do that. You just have to paste the URL. And the very last icon is the breakout rooms. So for any of you that have used Adobe Connect in the past, the breakout rooms are exactly like that. Let's just say this was a whole class of people. So the teacher, presumably having the host permissions, could say, all right, we're going to break up into groups and you're all going to talk about your projects. So what they would do is they would open up the breakout room. They'll say create breakout rooms. And then obviously it randomly assigns who goes into each breakout room, but you can obviously move them around. And then when they're done, they'll just hit open all rooms. Your other participants will get a notification saying that they have been invited. They can either join the room or join in later. And obviously I specified it says that that person is not in the room yet. And so now you can see that my other account is in there. So as the participant who is within the breakout room, you do have the option to leave the breakout room, but obviously when you come back, you'll probably still be in there. You do have the added button though to ask for help if needed. And as it says here, Caleb Boyko, student in breakout room 1, asked for help. And so now I'm within the breakout room with the students. And so now, like, if they had a question, presuming that I was the teacher, they could then ask me my question, and then when they're done, I just leave the breakout room. And then obviously when everything's said and done, you just hit close all rooms. It'll have a timer and the participant can either just force themselves back into this main area or they can wait for the 60 seconds to be up. So that's it. That's how you can make your own group meetings using Zoom. Zoom has many features that I would highly recommend that you play around with for yourself or go to the Zoom website for more information. So have fun, guys, and I will see you in the next video.